Now, what YFM is doing is we are making sure that we add a bouquet of creative and informative content on our station by hosting leaders and achievers in various sectors and industries in Ghana and beyond, in bringing hope, meaning, development, and leadership coaching tips to our vibrant listenerships, followers on radio, and across our social media platforms as well. Now, from the classroom to the boardroom, this man we're about to talk to today has been no stranger to strategy and strategic thinking, okay? Our guest today is a retired banker with 30 years experience and also serves on many boards, including the advisory board for the College of Humanities for the University of Ghana, Foundation of Orthopedic and Complex Spine Focus, Metropolitan Life Ghana Limited, Quality Insurance Company Limited, Legacy Bond Limited. He's also the chairman of the Achimota Golf Club Property Development Committee. He was the first appointed chairman for the National Health Insurance Council. Also, he is a chairman of the Ghana Stock Exchange and a member of the first Ghana Bonds Committee and Advisory Committees, which set up the IDE Fund and Fund. In 2013, he was conferred with an honorary doctorate degree by the University of Ghana for his contribution to tertiary education. He is an honorary fellow of the Chartered Institute of Bankers and also an alumnus of the Oxford Strategic Leadership Program, said Business School, Oxford University. Mr. Frank Edu, former MD of CALBank, joins us on the Why Leaderboard Series today via Zoom. I think this is the second time we're doing this via Zoom. If you're locked in right now, you can join in on Facebook. Just search for Y1079 FM Ghana. Our WhatsApp line is 0202222073. You can be a part of the conversation as well. If you have any question for Mr. Frank Edu, kindly send them through. He's live on here. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Reverend King. Thank you for having me. Good morning to you.
It's a pleasure to have you on here. I hope you're having a good day.
So far, so good.
Great. I'm going to move straight into business. We've heard so much about you. I mean, the portfolio I just read is quite impressive. You've been in the banking sector for a very long time, somewhere around 30 years. You've spent so much time in ensuring that Ghana's financial grows into what it's supposed to get into. But beyond that, let's talk about where Mr. Frank started life. I mean, let's talk about your family, where you grew up. I mean, let's start off with that.
Okay, so thank you very much. My siblings and I lost our mother in 1965. Just 3 years. And father moved from Ofori Island to 1967, where we lived in the airport residential area in Manor House, because my father was a civil servant. He opted not to marry again, so we grew up with my dad. Boys and a girl. The girl, my sister Magma, was 14 months older than me. She had to go and live with my auntie because it was thought that my father couldn't bring up a four-year-old girl. And myself and my younger brother, George, lived with my dad. Then my dearly departed brother, Honorable Jimmy Dunbar, at the time was 6 weeks old. So he stayed with my grandmother and subsequently joined us when he was about 7 or so years old. But we grew up in a very happy home. My father was a disciplinarian. Very bright, honest individual, charged, civil servants, and very loving and caring. So that was basically the home I grew up in.
Did this by any chance influence your development into who you are today?
My father had a good influence on me, and growing up, he was my best friend as well. He was very honest, very much with Nigerian, lived in education, would make sure that you read everything and anything every day and started your books. You know? So, yes, my father left a huge impression on me. Growing up without anyone also in the house probably had some effect on me. Possible negative, I'll leave that for other people to judge.
Okay. I think I can relate to that. I also grew up without, you know, the father figure. And so I perfectly understand. It does have a lot of influence on how we develop you know, from that time upwards. But I mean, it's when I weigh it, the positive side is usually bigger than the negative side. Maybe we'll have time to talk about that in the near future. Sure. Let me find out from you. Growing up, did you have a dream job other than what you found yourself doing in the course of your career?
When I was growing up, to be honest, my preferred profession would have been sportsman. So,
sportsman?
Yes. If I'd grown up in a place like the United States of America where professional sports was highly developed, I probably would have played baseball for a living, you know.
Wow.
Sports was natural with me. So that was what I'd have loved to do. But obviously, in the 60s growing up, you're not going to tell your father that you're going to play football for Ghana. He'll probably tell you that there's something wrong with you. You know, so we had to adjust accordingly.
Was sports a big thing back then?
Not really. It was basically football and boxing. Okay. You know, but in the secondary school years, you had field hockey, you had volleyball, very little basketball. You know, so and I played all those sports. So for me, sports came very, very naturally to me. So I've given the chance that I'm a sportsman.
Okay. I think back then, if the interest for baseball was still in, was it what we called Chaskele?
Yes, you could say that.
Okay, I think it's fair because when you said baseball, in my mind, I'm like, Ghana. And then I remembered, okay, we all used to play Chaskele growing up.
Yeah.
Anyways, now, what were some of the things you enjoyed doing while growing up? Aside having interest for sports?
I remember I really enjoyed playing cards with my father.
Cards,
yes. Cards.
Okay.
As you call it in Ghana, spa.
Yes, yes.
Yes, and that's how I learned my three times table, age 3 or 4, because you were scoring in threes, Ayeli, you know. I play cards like that every day. But of course, I also like playing with my friends. And I like to draw. I used to draw a lot. You know, and I went on to do art. So I remember growing up, playing cards with my dad, drawing a lot, and playing sports, all kinds of sports, you know, was what made me happy.
Now, take us through your educational ladder. Where did you start school? And what was the last school you attended?
Okay, so I'm a product of the public school system. What is called CITO. I went to the Road Methodist Primary. It's in another class of schools, right behind the cathedral. Yes, somewhere behind the cathedral. I elected in those days, you wrote common entrance in middle school. Elected to write common entrance in classics. A few of us, I think we were maybe 20, 21 in the school. I was lucky I passed. So I went and I chose, I chose Achimoto School, but my father finished it because my father was a professor. And he didn't see how he was going to explain to Reverend Sinti, he said, who's a big person. This were his mates, why his son was going to Achimoto School. So I went to Prusak, and I'm very glad I went to Prusak. I made some great friends. That was a very good school. In my O level at Prusak, my A level at Prusak, and from Prusak I went to University of Ghana. Well, when I wrote my A level, I told you that I did A level. As a matter of fact, in 6 subjects instead of 4. So I got invited to and I chose architecture at Tech. I got invited to Tech for an architectural course, and there was an interview panel. I went for the interview and I froze. was asked to scratch a bicycle in my foot. I could not scratch a bicycle. I just froze. I was 18 years old. So I failed. But I'm happy to see that the following year, my sister went for the same interview and passed. So my sister is an architect. So I came back to Legon and I was offered geography, English, and ancient history classics. So I majored in geography and minored in ancient history and came out of university in 1984. Deferred from 83 because in that period was the 81 revolution and we served for 10 months. Carrying cocoa for 1.5 months. So basically that's what happened. And my father was insistent that you had to get a degree, you know, English trained servant. He wasn't a businessman. He needed to go to school, get a university degree, and get a college job. Basically, that's the influence that he had.
Okay. Let's speak about aspirations in general. Before we get to the bigger part of your education, I mean, the university side, growing up, you told us what you would have become if you had not taken this career path. What were your aspirations as a child? What did you want to grow to become? Who did you want to become growing up?
I'm not sure that I had any... aspirations which were extraordinary, but I would be a professional sports person. That wouldn't happen. And then when I finished university, I became a teaching assistant. I realized that I love teaching. So I tried to become a lecturer. I also was frustrated somewhat, but that's another story. And then I decided, look, it's a integration. So I actually walked out of the University of Ghana. I was a lecturer. I just walked out. I just resigned one afternoon. And I was stuck with I found myself unemployed, you know. And I went for an interview at Merchant Bank. There were about 35 of us. Shortlisted to two, and the job was given to the other person. And when I inquired why, they said, well, he did economics, he did geography. So whilst he did well at the interview, you're well enough, so we're going to be able to employ you. I remember driving straight from Merchant Bank, the University of Ghana, during which time I started applying for master's programs in Canada and the US. Okay. I drove straight to the University of Ghana and applied for the MBA course. That's how I ended up in finance for my master's and then in the government sector. So there was no particular aspiration. You know, I was just like, basically, if you can put it that way.
Back in uni, University of Ghana, you read geography for your first degree. And then after that, you made a quick U-turn into finance for your MBA. What inspired that drift?
Listen, Red, I was just looking for a job, you know.
You were just trying to survive.
I was just trying to survive. I was just looking for a job. I never thought growing up that I'd be a banker.
Okay.
My maths was lousy. I got a 6 in O-level maths. I barely passed. You know, after business school, where I opted to do finance instead of marketing, which the school was trying to get me to do, I said, look, it wasn't rocket science. Anybody who applied themselves to it can do it. So I ended up with a good job, you know, in a highly visible sector. And today, 30 years old.
Mr. Frank, do you believe in
fate?
Do you believe in fate?
I believe in faith, yes, I do.
And so you believe that turn was not just to survive, but it was an original calling for your purpose?
It's possible. You know, there's one thing that I I do not challenge anything that happens to me. I believe that there's always a divine reason, there's a purpose, a divine purpose. I do not regret nor challenge anything that happens to me. I will not see anything negative. I will try and profit or make anything that happens, take advantage of it. So if you can, if you call that fate, fine. Because clearly I wasn't meant to be an architect.
Yeah.
I wasn't meant to be a lecturer. I remember going to talk to some of the highways when I was looking for a job, whether they would take me and then turn me into a pilot. They told me that they don't employ graduates as pilots. You know? So if you call that fit, yes.
Did you at any point want to give up while you were trying and things were not working? I mean, you've mentioned that you tried a few things. Yeah, I mean.
Give up. Did you say give up?
Yes.
Did you? Why would anybody give up? At 22, you don't give up. At 70, you don't give up. You know, you should never give up. Until the Lord takes your breath away, you should never give up.
I like that energy. You spent 30 years with CALBank, with 19 years as MD, and growing it from a 3-branch to a 28-branch bank employing 850 people. What key lessons do you learn as an individual from this success story that you can pass on to the youth? I mean, people listening now.
Well, you know, it was 30 glorious years at the bank, and it's been a life lesson and a life university for me. In those years, I learned about the human being and how complex a human being is. I learned about commitment and perseverance. I learned that you cannot do it all. You've got to build teams, and the team will carry you. I learned about character and attitude. I learned that there are no shortcuts in life. And this is for the youth. There are no shortcuts in life. I learned that a good solid foundation is always required. I learned that if you treat people right, they'll carry you. I have to say this, that the guys at CALBank carried me. For the 20 years or so that I was MD, they carried me and supported me and made it possible for me to succeed. And I learned that there's a superior being who makes all things possible. You must always be thankful. These are the lessons that I learned in the 20 years or 30 years that I was at the bank.
Do you remember your first day working at CALBank?
It's interesting. That question is interesting, you see, because I joined CALBank informally in August 1989. Everybody else came 1st March 1990. So
you were there a year before?
Like 8 months. You know, so Redanko and I and a gentleman called Ousu Amoa were basically putting everything together. And I was running around buying furniture, working with masons, electricians, and air conditioners. And then Yofi Grant and another gentleman called Amu Jent. But the bank then opened its door to formal employees in March and opened its door to the public in July. You know, so I remember the first suit I wore to the office, you know, was on cheap, I think it was on £50 suit that I bought from Mr. Wright in London in 1987.
Hello?
Yeah.
Good. Now, follow-up question to that, though. First day you worked officially with the bank, I mean, let's clear the 8 months pre-work experience. Official work began. You mentioned earlier on that you were just trying to survive with your career choice. I mean, first few days there, did you see yourself sticking with the bank for 30 years, or you saw yourself surviving and then moving on to somewhere else?
First and foremost, when I started at the bank, I enjoyed what I was doing. I was called senior analyst, and I was practicing exactly what I'd learned in business school, finance, public finance, everything. So for me, it was just a practical demonstration of what I had done and learned in school in the previous year. You understand me? So it was exciting. And I didn't have any aspirations as to whether I was going to leave or I was going to stay on. Then I was made treasurer. Okay, there's all kinds of things happened. Then I was made treasurer. And treasury CALBank was nascent. It was new. There was no basic platform for it. So I now took this thing up and built the treasury department, wrote the policy documents, everything. And it got more and more exciting. You understand me? I haven't done that and done all kinds of interesting stuff in that. The board said, listen, we should look at this young man and made me a deputy MD after 5 or so years. And at that point, the sky was not even the limit. They're moving very, very fast. You know? But then again, I'm also a very patient person, you know, and I believe I have this cathedral mentality, which is if you take your time, which is how I talked about one of the lessons learned was that you build a solid foundation. Yeah. And so the cathedral mentality, I realized that, look, if you take your time and you build a foundation, you can really develop your career and make something good out of whatever it is that you do. You don't need to move around.
Wow. We're going to talk about banking these days. I mean, your experience there. You know how you got in and how things were back then setting up CALBank out here. I'm going to put that on hold. You once stated that banking or the banking sector does not endear itself to the public. What, in your opinion, did CALBank do differently and how young people can position themselves to do things differently in order to succeed?
Well, I mean, CALBank tried to be customer-centric. We tried to be friendly. And we tried to be very supportive of business. You see, when people talk about banks and bankers are vilified only because our numbers are transparent and visible, and then we tend to wear big suits and expensive shoes, big cars, etc. You know, but people have to understand that without business, banks don't survive. Because the sum total of everything that happens in an economy ends up in the vaults and the books of banks. Yeah. So banks need the people. And businesses more than a big businesses need banks, you know. So we haven't recognized that. At CALBank, we made it a point to always give the customer a better experience, to understand the customer. Not so if you look at our balance sheet whilst I was there, and I think the same thing it still persists. We focused on medium to long-term loans as opposed to short-term import loans. Because short-term import loans basically just will make somebody rich, but doesn't develop the country. And we can talk about going forward because you focus on imports and you're bringing all kinds of useless products from other countries, inflating your economy and developing other economies. What we did at CALBank was that minimum about 50% of our loan book was to industry, 5-3-7 year loans to build capacity, to develop industry so that productivity would grow. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen across the board in the banking sector. And I don't see government encouraging that either. But if we did, and we shifted the collective strength of balance sheets in this country into developing the productive sector, we'll make a huge difference. I have arguments and discussions at high levels with at least two high level sessions with presidents. Okay. And on all occasions, I have asked a very simple question. And I think people have known that my position on this. Why do you have a minister for trade and industry? You should not have a minister for trade and industry. Because why not? What if the minister sits down, what is he going to push? Is he going to push trade or is he going to push industry? If you push industry suffers. Because trade is import substitution, basically.
Yes. Yes.
But industry is trade. What do you call it? Industry is import substitution.
Yes.
Because if you push industry, then I'm going to produce the things that I need, and I'm not going to import. The point is that probably imports gives quicker revenue, short-term revenue. Yes. You know what I mean? So that minister is always going to push, he's going to look at it and say, how do I make an impact on this economy? I have only 4 years for trade.
Yes.
If you keep supporting trade, you will never develop your economy. So I insist that you must separate that industry and don't make them friends. Let them compete for resources. Because we've got more resources in industry than we put in trade. When we were growing up, we were not importing rice. Right now, we everything. And we've killed industry. We can't continue paying lip service to industrial development when everything favors trade. Split that ministry up and let the Minister for Trade and Minister for Industry be enemies. Let them compete. Exactly.
That's a very important fact. I mean, wow. Let me just hold on to my thoughts for now. We're going to get talking about that in a bit. From all you said, CALBank was able to grow through these years solely on private sector support, right? It's clear that there wasn't enough help from the government. I mean, the system hasn't been very favorable to private sector businesses, some of them including, of course, CALBank. What is your advice to young business owners or new entrepreneurs who want to thrive or want to grow their business off the government support? I mean, without the government support.
It's a very good question, right? And but it's also a very difficult situation. Mm. It's a developing economy. And the statistics, last time I looked, something like 70% of all business emanates directly or indirectly from government. So it's going to be very, very difficult for you to say that you're going to grow your business and not take government into consideration. You have to contend with government. Governments will change every 4 years. That even makes it more complicated. But you also have to understand that because of the fact that government changes every 4 years, if you develop your business solely on government, you run a big risk. We all know what happens with governments and all the things that one has to go through. You finance a road contractor, he does the roads, he's not paying on that. So 3 years later, he's not giving it, and then he goes into debt, etc. It's a matter of, again, government providing the infrastructural framework and the tired cliche of enabling environment for individual businesses to thrive. But it's also a matter of expanding the private sector so that if I am a farmer, for instance, I don't need to sell my produce to the stock company before I'm able to sell my products. I should be able to, the market should be opening up and big enough for me to be a farmer and depend on the private sector for my produce. That's what I mean. We must find ways and means of insulating all manner of business, especially the productive sector, from government interference, from dependence on government. Government can take their taxes, but they must provide avenues for us to do our business privately without interference and successfully. But again, probably power, influence, etc., government wants to be involved. So, and I think it's going to be very difficult for government to say, look, we're not going to get involved, but we're going to make it possible for businesses to thrive. It's a tough one.
Let's talk about banking in Ghana. Mm-hmm. I mean, banking everywhere deals with money, people's money, human beings handling people's money. In your 30 years experience as a banker, what, in your opinion, makes someone a good banker and then a bank or an entity involved in banking a good banking brand? Two questions.
Can you repeat the questions?
What makes someone a good banker? And what makes a banking brand a good banking brand?
Okay. I think it's probably the question. A good bank must understand the needs of the people and provide what the people want. Mm-hmm. But you have also provided in a very friendly environment. Mm-hmm. You know, I think that over the years, banking in Ghana has evolved, and more the customer has become powerful, which should be the case. Mm-hmm. When we started banking, people would queue up at the end of the month in the banking halls all the way out for their salary. And the bank thought that they were doing this for their favor. What happens now with competition? If I have to queue in your banking hall, I'm not going to come back. I'm going to go somewhere else. You know, so I think a good banker takes the needs of the people into consideration and provides the environment within which you can deliver your financial services in a friendly and convenient manner to the benefit of the customer.
Okay.
It must always be to the benefit of the customer.
And so if I'm to pick from your answer, a good banker should be someone who toes the line of all these good qualities of a good bank, right? Somebody who doesn't deviate from all these.
Right. Within it of the law.
Okay. All right. Now, CALBank has been there for a while. You've been with them since the genesis. Now, a lot of things have developed thanks to technology. There's mobile banking. There's the e-banking. I don't know if they're the same. There are a lot of ATM machines around. You must have seen the introduction of this new system up to date. How was the reception like back then, you know, when these ways were introduced? What were some of the challenges you had to deal with?
Okay, so CALBank, EchoBank, and I think CALBank, years ago, almost 20 years ago, introduced a card called the e-card.
Okay.
It was the first electronic card in this market. Mm-hmm. And we had all kinds of issues. As far as I was concerned, it wasn't rocket science. Okay? Albert Essien at the time at EchoBank thought same. And the gentleman at TrustBank was a Belgian, I forgot his name. And we went ahead and did this. But we had all kinds of problems from in the central bank.
Okay.
Through to the cleanliness of our electricity supply. So, let me cut the story short. We had to kill that car. And we had problems from even our own colleague, competitor banks. Hmm. You know, so, and that was this when electronic banking was not something that anybody was thinking about. Fast forward, ATMs, etc. I can tell some scary stories, but again, it's not a platform for me. But yes, there were all kinds of difficulties. ATMs, for instance, were so expensive when we started. They cost up to $25,000 a machine, which is ridiculous. Because what is an ATM? Wow. ATM is a vault. It's a small vault. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to develop an ATM, network, you're paying $20,000 for one piece of one small vault. You know? Yeah. So those were difficulties. So we had to engage NCR and all kinds of things. Now, mobile money comes in. Mobile money is very, very interesting. I think some people think that the banks didn't catch on early enough. I don't think so. I think the way it was structured in Ghana and understood by the authorities made it very, very difficult for the banks to partner and be a part of. So those challenges also worry the banks a bit, but over time, I think those are being resolved. But we now have a serious monopoly, basically, where one company controls about 75%, and I see NCAs have been asked to try and bring that monopoly, which is very good.
Okay.
When it comes to mobile money and e-banking, the banks are caught on. forget the difficulties, it's the way to go. And the banks would rise to the occasion. COVID has accelerated the need for all manner of platforms to be developed for to deliver banking services. And I think we really see that slowly. Irrespective of what the difficulties that will come with it.
Okay. All right. Before I move on to my next question, let me find out from you. Every job, every profession has its misconceptions. In your many years working with a bank, what would you describe as the wildest or the craziest misconception? Something you heard about banking that you laughed. And of course, the reality behind it. I heard while I was growing up that bankers have access to the money and they can actually go pick any amount they like, provided they bring it back. Until I grew up and started studying economics and then realized that it's not actually the truth. I'm sure you must have heard a few. Share one with us and tell us the reality behind it.
No, but I think that what you heard could probably be true, but it's a crime.
Okay.
You understand me?
It's true, but it's a crime.
It's a crime. I mean, I think that if you go to the history of it, there are cases where people have actually gone into a vault and taken money, but it's stealing.
It's not in the context of the law.
It's stealing. You understand me? Now that you do e-banking, etc., you could also have a situation where people will connive, gate, and transfer monies to accounts. It's stealing. So I don't think that they're necessarily misconceptions, but they are acts of crime.
Okay.
They are acts of crime.
It's financial month. Money Sense Month on GMABC across all our platforms, ETV, Happy FM, YFM. We're actually educating our listeners on managing their money better. What do you think are the key things you think the youth need to be aware when it comes to saving and building wealth for themselves? Things to look out for.
Rev, have you seen a cathedral?
Yes.
A proper cathedral, like the dome.
There's one in Kumasi. I think Roman Hill, the Catholic Church, the one on the hill.
So I'm talking these, like St. Paul's Cathedral.
Yes.
Plus in all these huge cathedrals around Europe.
Yes.
Those cathedrals were built in an era when Europe was ruled by kings and queens.
Okay.
The king who decided to build a cathedral would have employed an architect. Design the cathedral, and then employed a builder who started. The king, the architect, and the initial builder would not see the end of the completion of the cathedral.
That's true.
The dome in Cologne, for instance, took 600 years to build. What I'm trying to say here is that for the young coming up, you must have a cathedral approach, long-term cathedral approach to wealth creation. As I said earlier, there's no shortcuts in making money. Okay. So in this, if you have a long-term cathedral thinking, you must start by living within your means. Working at a bank, one of my colleagues who used to run a non-bank financial institution said to me that, Frank, you know, it's amazing. My best customers are bank employees. I said, what do you mean? He says, and bank employees get loans at subsidized rates, let me put it that way, interest rates, as part of the X. And yet, they go and they borrow at ridiculous, almost usurious rates from these non-banking financial institutions. Why? Because they want to keep up the Joneses, because they want to live beyond their means. If you are a young man or young woman growing up, you cannot do that. You should not do that. When I was growing up, my father said to me, young man, you must never borrow for recurrent expenditure. You must live within your means. In fact, if you can afford it, save 50% of your salary every month and invest it. That is a mentality that the youth of today must have. They should not try and follow the Joneses. Everybody in Ghana now, before COVID, wants to take his family or her family to Dubai for holiday. even when they don't have the money, or to New York, to Disneyland, to Disney World. It's not, those things are not going to go away. You cannot spend all your money as a young man on these things that, for me, are non-essential. You understand me? So if you want to be wealthy, or you want to build wealth, you have to save, you have to invest, you have to live a frugal and modest life until you make enough and you can live a luxurious life. And the other thing that I want to say to them is that, you know, your lifestyle must not change simply because you retired. The lifestyle you built whilst you're working, you understand that the older you grow, the less your ability to generate wealth and income.
That's true.
But so what happens most people that as they retire, their lifestyle begins to go down.
Yeah,
advice, you must make sure that you plan such that as you grow, your lifestyle remains constant.
And how do we ensure this? Saving itself is something we were not really introduced to growing up. I mean, it's not really inculcated in our educational system from the onset.
True.
And yesterday I read somewhere that it's good to save, but it's better to invest.
Yes.
If I save a specific amount of money every month towards my retirement, and then let's say I work for 20 years or you work for 30 years, naturally, what I'm able to save should be able to sustain me for an extra 30 years. What if I live beyond 30? Or I'm supposed to save from the savings?
So you actually answered yourself. You can't invest without saving. You understand me? So if you earn 100,000 CDs a month, you spend 50,000 and you save 50,000. When that 50,000 after a year is 600,000 CDs, you can now look at other forms of investments. You understand me? So that form of investment could be, you can start a business and then you leverage that 600,000 by taking a modest loan to that business, which will take care of you in your retirement. But if you do not save, you cannot invest. If you don't invest, you cannot build wealth.
That's true. Now, let's talk a little bit about leadership and this whole COVID-19 situation. You are vehemently opposed to economic reform programs that come with bonus assistance as the banking sector gives more in terms of taxes to governments. Now, the president has reinforced your position with his Ghana Beyond Aid mantra. Just how feasible is this, and what critical interventions must government make to achieve it? Ghana Beyond Aid.
So, let's say you have a warehouse full of grain.
Okay.
And it is under attack from mice, rodents. So you go and get two cats, okay? Because you know cats will always chase and eat mice. But when you get the cats, you feed the cats in your kitchen. They have a hearty breakfast, then you put them in the warehouse. So what do you think will happen? When they see the mice, they will just look at the mice and sleep. Do not attack the mice. That is what aid does to us. Aid blunts your ability to think and to try and generate wealth for yourself and employment, which is why I have a problem with aid. I believe in hard work. You understand me? Successive governments, for whatever reason, but in my opinion, purely mainly because of corruption, have been and misuse the resources of this country. And the Western world supports you because you do that with them. Then they give you aid. Why don't you give me aid? We have resources. I believe that some years back, Madagascar, the president of Madagascar threw out the IMF and says, we don't want your aid. They struggled, but they made it. Why can't we do the same? You know? Which is, I have a problem with aid. And so if you ask me how feasible it is, I'll say it is feasible because other countries have done it. So we must support the private sector and build the infrastructure to develop the private sector. But we must, in doing so, if we don't curb corruption, it's not going to happen. But we must also be unapologetically supportive of local businesses. You know, Rev, if a foreign, and I had this argument under one of the governments. So two clients of mine were building hotels. Mm-hmm. They don't have any tax exemptions. A foreigner comes and is building a hotel, and he has complete and absolute exemption of all taxes and duties. Mm-hmm. I'm asking the chief of staff at the time, why? What is wrong with this Ghanaian? He's competing the same market with this foreigner. Is it because it's foreign direct investment and because you're encouraging foreign direct investment? How about domestic direct investment? If you do that, you are not empowering the local private sector to go into business. What will happen is that almost all the loans would be taken up by Indians, Lebanese, and Syrians.
Yes.
Because they'll be quick to it. But if you do an indigenous fund, it is saying that I am giving this fund to this money to Ghanaians. Well, we all know, and my Lebanese friends should forgive me, that they will always export their capital, their profits back to Lebanon.
They never invest here.
Yes, they don't. They make the money and they take it out. But even an indigenous fund, you are giving it to an indigene.
And this person is going to set up here.
Absolutely. You know, and we must be shy about it. I don't see, and it's happening. It's happening under every government it happens.
So, I mean, it's feasible if we are ready to eliminate these things you've talked about. Corruption must be worked at. It must be fought. We must empower the indigenous people. Right? I mean, these are the things you mentioned right now are things some of us are privileged to, information some of us are privileged to. But it's not really widely out there. People don't know. And so there's a lot of confusion when a young Ghanaian guy comes down with a Ghanaian passport and wants to invest into a business here. A lot of challenges in setting up. After you set up, even access to loans and all these things are not favorable. And so if you are not strong enough, you fall out. And then in this same situation, we're trying to go beyond aid. I mean, realistically speaking, if we're not able to wake up and fight directly at the things that are serving as hindrances, I mean, it's going to be a project that we just work on, but governments will come and go and the situations will be the same. Anyways, let's move on. Now, earlier on in the conversation, you touched on exports and imports. I mean, you mentioned that we must export more than we import. Our economy primarily suffers because we do the opposite. I mean, you haven't been in the business space for 3 decades. Is it that easy to manufacture most of what we need looking at global economic factors, you know, as a country? Is it that easy?
No, it is not. But you see, Red, nobody gives you independence on a silver platter. Mm. It's not in the interest of the Western world to have African or developing economies be self-sufficient. Mm. So you have China support their businesses and flood your market with cheap goods. You have US saying the US supports their grain producers.
Yes.
That's what I mean. But it doesn't mean that we must sit here and take it from them. We must also go through the pain. And in our case, we do not even have to reinvent the wheel. We've seen what has happened. Some GMO, for instance. I have problems with GMO. Not because it probably is not healthy. People talk about yield. But I say to them, if my grandmother in the village plants a bushel of corn on a hectare of land, end of the day, when she harvests the corn, she leaves some for the next planting season.
That's true.
She has food independence and control over her own commercial activity as a farmer. Today, You are saying that when she plants that corn at harvest, all the corn that she harvests, they're all sterile. She has to go to a company which is based in the US and has an agent here and buy seeds for that company. That takes away immediately the independence that my grandmother had,
yes,
to her own food. It says now that you are also now beginning to import your basic diet. And for me, it doesn't matter what the economic argument. I had a huge argument with the minister, and he says, "Look, but the GMO for one kilo of seeds, we get 10 tons. But in the normal one, 1 kilo, we get 2 tons." And I said, "That happens to economic independence." Yes, I mean, you are also not doing that way to the foreigner. So it's not going to be easy. But I think that politicians, because of the tenure that they have to take these shortcut measures. And that is exactly why we also now have to look at our political dispensation. Because short-term measures will never, ever develop this country. And on this one, I want to make a point. People may challenge me if they want to. Somebody should tell me which country in this world developed their economy on universal adult suffrage. Not one. All of Europe developed under kingdoms. Mm-hmm. And even America today has not used universal adult suffrage. That is why they have the electoral college. But here in Africa and in Ghana, we are using universal adult suffrage, one man, one vote. That is utopian. It is never, in 4-year cycles, it will never develop this country. Mm-mm.
Whoever has plans for the country with regards to development has it for the next
four years.
And I believe our development plans beyond 4 years.
It has to be 50.
And I mean, this is also an issue because, well, people do get tired of governments. They want to switch them. But then if I feel we have a uniform system for development, one such that regardless of the government that comes, because it's been tried and tested, we still toe that same line, regardless of political ambitions. We know that, okay, if we're developing the health sector, we're developing the export industry or the import industry, this is how we're doing it. Regardless the party, you come and then you follow it. I think we can move forward.
Yes. We must have a development plan which is non-political, non-partisan. Mm-hmm. So if, like, abolish manifestos of parties, when you come, this is the state we reach with this development plan, you continue.
Yes.
That's you understand me?
That's very true.
You continue.
That's very, very important. Let's come back to the youth and the young people listening to us. One of the books of your gospel, or the gospel according to Mr. Frank Edu, is humility. You've so many times encouraged the youth to be humble and nice to people. In doing this, one thing that I've experienced or realized is that young people sometimes fall prey to leaders who exploit their talent and skill with no commensurate benefits. I mean, you find people who will go humble and work under their bosses or their leaders for so many years, and their bosses become fat, their finances change, and you realize that these ones are still who they are just because they're humble. I mean, how should the youth, per your advice, still practice humility in the face of exploitation when they encounter any?
Exploitation will not go away. Like I said, independence is never giving. You have to grab it. You have to fight for it. And artisanship and things like that will always be there. During this period, it is your learning period as a youth. So you take from the person whom you are understanding or working with, the good sides. You work hard, you are humble, you are respectful, and time will come. You must always expect that people will take advantage of you. Mm-hmm. The human being is, it's human nature. But you must also be smart as an individual and understand when to make a move, if you have to make a move. Humility is as far as I'm concerned, is one of the best attributes that one can have. It does not mean that you are weak. You know, it just means that you know how to wash your hands the elders, and then the elders invite you to the table, and then you also make hay, as they say, when the sun shines or when the sun shines. But I will still encourage the youth to be humble in the physical condition. But you must guard yourself against expectation. You must also be smart enough to seize the moment when you get it. I don't want to give anecdotal experiences, but I had a client who started off as a young contractor and was very diminutive in stature.
Okay.
And he would go and sit at the Ministry of Finance and wait for a check. Everybody thought he was a messenger. He would dress very modestly and he would sit there. And they'll have pity on him, and then they'll give him his check and he'll go away. And so he became a big contractor. They didn't know that he was the owner of the company.
The owner, yeah.
He was the owner's messenger, you know. But out of that humility, right now he's one of the biggest contractors in the country. You know. So I think people must just understand that. And you see, humility, amongst other attributes, attitude, etc., compassion, empathy, and commitment, all make you the whole person.
Okay. Guys, we're still talking to Mr. Frank Adu Jr. He is the immediate past MD of CALBank Ghana. I'm really enjoying the conversation. If you're locked in right now, this is Y107.9 FM, Y Leaderboard Series. Be a part of the conversation by WhatsApp 0202222073. Before the conversation ends, I'm going to allow two people locked in now to send in their questions. So if you're one, you have a question for Mr. Frank, kindly send it through WhatsApp now. Or if you're locked in, you'd like to sign in with us, let us know you're locked in with us. Kindly send me your name, where your location, and then I will shout you out. So moving on, COVID-19 is here to stay. At least that's how our minds are being conditioned now. For some, it's an opportunity for an African renaissance. I mean, it's a worldwide renaissance. In your opinion, how should young Africans prepare themselves or take advantage of the opportunities COVID-19 presents despite the challenges?
I think that COVID provides an opportunity for African countries to move their economies forward. Let me say that the pandemic was unfortunate. You shouldn't lose lives, but that has happened. Unfortunately, some more lives may be lost going forward. But from the current point of view, let's take, for instance, the UK. The UK sat there, COVID came, and they were not ready, even with PPEs. Mm-hmm. They looked to China for PPEs. But Ghana, as a result of COVID, you have to give credit to the government, had this program to produce local PPEs and engage factories to start producing PPEs as opposed to looking to China or joining the scramble for PPEs. Mm. They said that our cloth, our fabric face masks must have now been certified by the WHO that you can use face masks. The point I'm trying to make is that COVID gives us an opportunity as a country to detail the areas that, the business areas that COVID has devastated, mm-hmm. and which as a country we can take advantage of, because it was an opportunity for us. So for instance, if you take the food industry, since COVID, you had big companies in the West, I don't want to mention names, from whom were importing things like pork, etc., collapse. So we can develop our own pork industry. We have some here, it's very small, but we can develop our own pork industry. Tourism,
that's true.
For instance, as I said earlier, we get up and we take our kids to Dubai, etc. Now, who wants to go and sit on the plane? Nobody wants to sit on the plane. Airports are shut, countries are stopped from coming. So why don't we develop our own internal tourist attractions? We have some, people get up elsewhere. How many people have been to even Shy Hills to look at the monkeys there? They have blue and orange monkeys. You have. You understand me? So for me, the opportunities in food, tourism, travel, IT services. Today, you and I, we are on Zoom. But Zoom is hosting this and Zoom is coming out of the, I don't know where Zoom is, the company. All I know is that since COVID, the share price of Zoom or the market cap of Zoom has more than tripled. Yes. So what happened to Zoom? What stops IT guys? I'm not a nerd, but I'm not an IT person. But what, I don't think that hosting a Zoom platform or having a Zoom platform of this nature is rocket science. Mm-hmm. So I think COVID presents young Africans with several opportunities, and you don't even need government to say that I'm setting up a COVID inventive or whatever team to look at. A bunch of private sector guys who can come together and look at opportunities that are coming out. And once we take advantage of this, by the time COVID is cleared, we wouldn't need the Western influence that will come and disturb us. You know, so I see opportunities for the youth, for the country, right out of the ashes of COVID.
Thank you for that. You seem like a very busy man with all the activities you have during the day. I want to find out how you balance work and family life.
There was a CEO, two CEOs. Mm-hmm. One of them, Harold Janine, I think he was the CEO of American Telephone and Telegraph, AT&T. Mm-hmm. He said, excuses are excuses. Explanations are explanations. Mm. Only performance is reality.
Okay.
The other one said, I've forgotten his name, but he was asked a question, how is he able to achieve all these things? And he says, when something has to be done, I just do it. So for me, when something has to be done, I just do it. I don't give explanations. I don't give excuses. I have to go to work, I go to work. I have to take care of my family, I take care of my family. I have to go to church with my family, I go to church with my family. You know, you just have to make sure that you balance what you have to do at work, find time for family, find time for recreation, and most importantly, find time for sleep. Mm. You know, and so that is, listen, Rev, if you hardly find me at a funeral. So I'm not making a good politician. I think a funeral is a waste of resources and time. You know, if I go to a funeral, I won't stay there for more than 30 minutes. It doesn't matter how it is. Yeah, Sammy. Weddings, yes, once in a while. But all these social activities which take you away for 4 or 5 hours, is one of those things I cut out of my life. I'd rather go play golf or something like that.
They steal your time.
Yes, your time must be used properly. Mm. No apologies.
Wow. Anyways, let me find out. Are any of your awards by any chance in finance now?
No, none of them is. They thought their father's job was too boring and too stressful. So, and I'm one of those fathers who leaves you to do what it is that you want to do. I'll support you.
Wow. Why did it look boring to them? How many hours do you spend at a bank?
Okay.
Were you spending at the bank back then as an MD?
So one of them came to do an internship at the bank. And after a month or so, he said to me that, I don't think that they pay you enough. This work is too much. And so he decided that he wasn't going to do finance. You know?
While you were MD at the bank, did you at any point realize, okay, one of your workers is not supposed to be here? I mean, I'm not trying to say you fired them, but then did you reach out to any of them to say, okay, pair your dedication and how you do your things? I feel this is not supposed to be your field. I mean, were you able to give such advice to your workers at any point?
Actually, before I became CEO, one of my colleagues, he was also head of department. Mm-hmm. And he had challenges. Very brilliant guy. He only got agitated when he was talking theory, funny theory. So I went to his office one day. I said to him, you know something, my friend? I think you should quit banking. I think you should go and teach at the banking college, etc. And he disagreed with me. Eventually, he was fired. He was fired for performance.
Okay. All right. So let me just, before I get on to the next question, can you see the third person in the shot right now?
I can see Malcolm Proud. What is he doing? Yeah. Jeez.
Surprise, surprise.
Surprise, surprise.
Welcome to the interview, Mr. Malcolm.
Well, thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Nice. Good to have you on. You've known Mr.
Yes,
Frank for many years. Off,
yes,
off the screens, off what people know, who is he?
He is what he appears to be. Hmm. Forthright, transparent, some say brash, but very competent. He loves what he does. He's passionate about what he does, whatever it may be. I can testify to that.
What do you love about
whether
him?
Whether it's playing golf, his transparency and his openness. I wouldn't say generosity, but he's a wonderful man. He's a wonderful man. Character is the most admired trait that he has that I respect a lot. He is who he appears to be. To everyone, not just me, but anyone I've ever seen him around, he's the same person.
Mm. Now, we're live on Ghana's biggest urban music station. We talk to the youth. And Mr. Frank is on today with us to basically share his life story with the youth to motivate and inspire us. From you to him as a friend, what words do you want to give him on such a special day? What do you want to tell him?
That I truly admire his tenacity. He's a smart guy. I would tell him that. I think he would probably acknowledge he's an analytical person. But I think probably the thing that I've grown to respect the most is his ability to lead people. People at the bank were very loyal. They were they knew that if they worked hard, they'd be treated fairly. If they didn't work hard, also be acknowledged. But it was a very pleasant environment to be for me. I totally enjoyed the association.
Well, thank you so much for taking time off your day to speak to us. I can see from his facial expression, he's very surprised though. Mr. Frank, you want to say anything to Mr. Malcolm before he gets off the line?
Yeah, you know, Malcolm and I go back a long way. We both sat on that, worked in that bank for 30 years. Malcolm actually was one of the initial investors in CALBank. Actually, was the first African-focused private equity fund. We run a successful private equity fund in the U.S. for many, many years. You know, and he guided me through my career. When I first met him, I was 28 years old, you know, and he was, much more handsome than he is. Right now, he's he gave me a lot of support on the board of, a lot of support on the board of CALBank, you know, and I'm very, very, we played a lot of golf together, and I'm happy to see on all occasions I took his money. Malcolm, thanks a lot.
I gave you
thank you
money.
So much, Mr. Malcolm. All right.
Thank you.
Have fun, guys.
All right. The best,
thank
right?
You. Thank
all
you.
Right.
Thank
we have a viewer watching us from Machina, Yobo State in Nigeria. Good morning, going out to all our Nigeria listeners and viewers right now. Mr. Frank, now that we've spoken to Mr. Malcolm, tell me a little bit about friendship. What advice do you have for young people in choosing the kind of friends that they have around them?
I always go back to my father. When I was growing up, my father told me I must have two kinds of friends. He says, when you're a young man, your friends must be minimum 25 years older than you. When you're an old man, your friends must be minimum 25 years younger. And this is the explanation he gave. And he said, when you're young and you have if you are 25 and your friends are 50, they won't envy you. And they will give you the benefit of their experience. You make less mistakes. Okay? Now, which is why maybe Malcolm and I have been friends for a very long time. Because Malcolm has always given me direction and advice. There's a gentleman also called Hisham Umayyad, may so rest in peace, who was my friend for many, many years. He died at the age of 83. Then he says, when you are old and your friends are younger, the benefit there is that they keep you in touch. Because you're 60, you're tired, but they are 35, 30 years old, you know. So right now, I'm cultivating much younger friends, you know, and one of the guys that I think is my, I don't want to mention his name, but he's a nerd, he's on radio every Tuesday or so, you know, and he keeps in touch with all these things that happen, all these technological things that happen. So my advice is that take your friends, people you call friends, should be people who can advise you, who will not be envious of you, who will walk with you, because when you walk together, you go forward. But when you walk alone, you're just passing by, may crash. But you must be
that's a good one. Wow. Let's talk about education.
Yes.
I mean, aside your stellar career in finance, you're also co-founder for the
Roman Rich School.
Yes, the Roman Rich School, and part of the advisory board of the College of Humanities for University of Ghana.
Yes.
What exactly does educating young minds mean to you? How dear is education to you?
Everything. You know, if we're going to change this country, we have to ignore my generation and the generation before me. The generation before me, before them, etc., they failed this country. The generation after independence up to my generation have failed this country. We're going to change rhetoric. We're going to focus on the young minds, ignore their parents, their grandparents, and change their rhetoric, my children and their children. You know, we have to reshape their minds and their psyche so that they love Ghana more than they love themselves. All the generation beyond me and above, we've been selfish. We have raped this country. We have taken from this country. We have not developed this country, you know. So we're going to go into education, teach their children something different. And I'm happy to say that I think that the young people of today, when I listen to them, they're a little bit more engaged. Mm-hmm. You know, they're a little bit more engaged because they've been out there, they've seen what has happened. And if we take advantage of this George Floyd incident in the US, we'll come back to live in our countries and love our country and develop our countries. You know what I mean? So for me, education is everything. Mm-hmm. We have to focus on the fertile young minds of the 5, 6, 7 year olds. Teach them what is right about the environment, morality, ethics, you know, commitment, loyalty, love of country, and change. Because when I listened to political figures on radio, on TV, I was aghast. One political figure, they were talking about bribery and corruption on one of the local TV stations. Mm-hmm. This is the statement he made, Infante. And when I finish, I'll translate it. He says, amazing, was it Bamejo? I said, was anybody to wait? Me, what is happening to me? I will take it. Man must eat. This is a political figure sitting on national TV making such a statement, infecting the minds of the young. So if you just as a role model, you would think that corruption is all right.
That's true.
I'm very passionate about this. But that's what I think about. That's why I'm interested in education.
You left out finance. Of course, you mentioned morality and all these things. At what age do you think children should be exposed to financial literacy?
It's never too early. You know, it's never too early. One of my sons, when he was in primary school, or even before primary school, was keeping his pocket money and buying toffees and selling toffees in school. When I found out, I encouraged him to continue. You know, so it's never too early to introduce children to financial literacy, and it's very important.
I'm interested in finding out or learning the story behind you co-founding a school like the Roman Rich School. Tell us how it started.
Somebody told you. Has somebody hinted you?
No.
Okay, so I was 25 years old. I had my first son, and a week after he was born, I went to the GIS school and wanted to enroll him. And the principal told me that I was too late. And I said, oh, boy is just a week old. You should have registered him before he was born. I said, but who does that? He says, that's what we do here. I said, so you cannot register him? He said, she says, no. So I looked at her and I told her that, listen, you know something, madam, I'll set up a school to rival GIS. Mm-hmm. And she says, I can't. I said, not a problem. So I left. So 19 years ago, I came together with, those days I used to play polo as well. So I came together with two friends of mine, and an Englishman from Cornwall. And we decided that, look, let's set up the school. So we pulled resources together. We rented the premises of the old French school. And we set up the Roman Rich School with 22 students, I think.
22 students?
Yes, 22. Fast forward, we needed a new principal. So we set up a board to interview applicants. Mm-hmm. And I went for this principal who denied my son entry into GIS as the chairman of the board. Did you say why?
Yes.
Why not? She had experience. So after the process, she came out to me and says, you actually set up a school to rival GIS. And I said, well, I promised I would. And I did. So like I told you, I believe anything that happens to me is good. I never see the negative signs back.
Wow. That's a good thing, actually. About 3 days ago, on one of our shows, we had a discussion around this. I mean, someone who experiences or has an awful experience with an individual months before they meet again, and they meet at an interview. And he is privileged to be interviewing the person for a job. Mm-hmm. And then the question is, the person qualifies perfectly well. But because of the personal experience they had in the past, the person is torn between saying no and letting the person walk away with all the qualities, or saying yes and dealing with the personal experience they had, you know, while the person is employed. I mean, I think that was a clear example of what you did.
You gave the personal experience you had. Yeah.
So you gave her a second chance.
Well, you know, it wasn't her policy, it was the school's policy, but she was immediately qualified for the job that I wanted done. So why not?
On youth development, others have suggested that young people need more of financial assistance and literacy and not too much mentoring. Where do you stand on this?
I think mentoring is more important. Yes, you see, financial assistance without mentoring, you could leave, your father could leave you $1 million. Mm-hmm. He passed on and you are 25 years old, 30 years old, 18, 22 years old. Mm-hmm. Without mentoring, that financial assistance that you've got, you can waste. And it happens a lot. You understand me? So I think that mentoring is very, very crucial for the youth. The youth need to be guided. My father gave me certain snippets of wisdom about savings and investments, etc. Yes, sir. And he also told me an anecdotal story of remembering your smock, which is a story I tell people as I mentor them. Always remember your smock. Yes, sir. I don't think that we have enough time to go into that little story, but it's mentoring is very, very key. If you do not mentor and coach, but you make financial resources available, you can be sure that financial resources will go to waste.
Wow. Final thing before we get to the next set of questions. I mean, you've had over 30 years experience in the finance industry. You are part of a lot of boards. You are impacting change in our society. You are into education. You are changing the trends of education out here. What is next for Mr. Frank Adu?
As I've said, you know, for me, for the 1 year following 31st December 2019, mm-hmm. it's all about rest, recreation, and recuperation.
The 3 R's.
And relaxation, 4 R's. Rest, relaxation, and recreation. I'm 30 years of hard labor. My body has taken a lot of punches, a lot of stress. I to relax a bit and get my health back and my health up. Get a little bit more hungry before I need to do anything else. So if you ask me today what it is that I want to do, I don't know.
I don't really know.
I started in my village, and that seems interesting, you know. Mm. For the moment, it's the 4 R's.
The 4 R's for you. Okay. So I'm looking or seeing beyond the 4 R's. We live in a country where... Yes, if you are super experienced, the best you can do is consult to ensure change is made, of course, through our leaders. Would you at any point consider taking up a ministerial position or a position on the highest leadership level here in Ghana, maybe a political position to ensure that the things that you believe in, the values, the things you think can change our country are well implemented? Would you consider that?
Rev, do you think I will be a good politician?
You would. You would make a good politician.
No, I won't. I won't make a good politician. So why go into an area where I believe I will not do well?
Well, I mean, you mentioned that if we're to move forward, development should be seen or should be void or devoid of partisan politics. What if it's just an appointment into a ministry? Maybe you serve as a deputy and there's no element of politics in there. Because I know there are people in parliament who are not really in the main realms of partisan politics, but are still diligently working towards developing our country. What if that comes up?
We'll see.
Okay. Obviously, after the 4 hours. Yes. When it happens, we'll bring you back here. So we talk more about it.
I'm happy to talk. Since I retired, a lot of TV stations, radio stations are trying to interview me. Mm-hmm. But I do not decline an invitation to address the youth. Mm-hmm. I always want an invitation to address the youth.
To address the youth. Mm. I love that. You are an avid sportsman. We know you play football, field hockey, squash, cricket, polo, and golf. Also, previously, you know, captain the Achimota Golf Club and the Accra Polo Club. What insights do you draw from these disciplines that can enable an individual to succeed, you know, from the sports perspective?
Competitiveness, discipline, acceptance of failure in dignity, acceptance of success or victory in grace. Sports makes you a very balanced human being. And it's unfortunate that today we don't play various sports in our senior high schools. You know, and if there's one thing that I wish we could do, would be to introduce sports again at a very active level in Kenyan schools. But sports gives you discipline, competitiveness, acceptance of failure in dignity, acceptance of victory or success in grace, and makes them a balanced human being.
Great. Now, you spent 30 years at CALBank. I'm quite certain that being the quintessential banker we know in this country, with some juicy offers and poaching attempts. I mean, a few might have come your way from competitors or CALBank in your early career days. What do you say to young ones who start off well and jump ships immediately? Higher salaries are offered to them. I mean, on the topic of loyalty.
I think that they should look at the bigger picture, in the long-term picture. We all get offers. I mean, once you sat me down from 8 p.m. to 3 a.m. trying to get me to switch from car to another bank, offered jobs in South Africa, offered to run a fund, and put the head office in any country of my choice, etc. But I basically said, look, I enjoy what I was doing at CALBank, and stuck with it. So my advice to the youth is, look at the bigger picture and the long-term picture. Jumping from job to job may give you some level of experience, but may not necessarily advance your career, you know. And as they say in my village, it's only when you pee in one spot that your pee will froth. The other one is a rolling stone gathers no moss. So you should, these are age-old sayings that must guide us and use as they develop their careers.
Mr. Frank, before we move on to the final question for you, we have voice notes from two mentees of yours. I mean, in your stellar career, you've mentored a lot of people. A few minutes ago, you said that financial assistance is not the best for the upcoming ones, but mentorship. And so we have two sound bites. Let's take a brief moment, listen. We have a few honest words to share with you.
Okay.
My name is Ernest David, the founder and chief executive officer of OUC International. And I'm here to congratulate my mentor and my father, Mr. Frank Eugene, the immediate pastor of CALBank, chairman from Irish schools. This is someone that I've known for the past 16 years. I remember in 2014 I worked in his office. Without an appointment, after listening to him in the schools. So I came to his office and then I shared my passion with him. He saw the passion that I was using to communicate my vision. So he immediately, without any hesitation, just accepted and threw a challenge before me. He said, look, Ernest, this thing is that you are doing. You must make sure that you succeed. It was a challenge to him. And by the grace of God, he didn't just lead us to go and succeed, but he was, and he has been with us all these years. And he's still with us. And I'm so proud of him. And through his advice and many others, we've been able to get international recognitions all over the world, which includes an invitation by the former president of South Africa. Nelson Mandela to his 90th birthday celebrations, and then also an invitation to Buckingham Palace by the Queen of England. So, Stephen is very passionate when it comes to youth development, and his advice are very accurate. I remember last year we were facing some challenge, and I walked to his office once again, and I told him the challenge that we faced, and just under advice, pushed the whole challenge to rest. So I am so proud of him. I am one of them. If anyone at all can leave it, I am still standing by him. And I can say that I am where I am today because of his advice and because of his commitment to see people of his career. So sir, I salute you today and I am so proud of you. The love is very deep. Thank you very much for making time always for us. Believing in us and for trusting us that yes, something good can come out of the
morning, sir. Good morning, listeners and wives. My thoughts on this issue generally, I'll share some personal experience I had with him. Once I called him, I mentioned to him, I wanted to learn. So he invited me to his office. While he was speaking, I sat and listened to him. And the only thing I could think to myself was, this is somebody who had planned his life right from the beginning. This is somebody who knew what he was going into right from the beginning, what he said from the day that he started. Three things, I mean, I'll make whatever it is that I have to say by choice. But three things that I'm dealing with today or working with him, that I think are examples. And if, I mean, young professionals who are even learning from will be helpful, is one, discipline. Two, investment. And by investment in everything in itself, in people. And the last and not the least is mission. He mentioned to me, Frank, I was investing then, not for myself, not for my children, but for my grandchildren. I think to a large extent, that is the thing. So, sir, congratulations to you. Yeah. Extremely proud of you. We say thank you. Thank you. And we pray that whatever legacy that you build will continue to live on. Enjoy your retirement. But some of us will keep coming back.
Uncle Frank, I hope you heard all that.
Well, there was an echo. So the first one was Waves International, right?
Yes.
The second one I didn't hear at all.
I'll get you. So the second person was, I think Ernest Davis. Ernest Davis was from Waves International. Yes. And the second one, I'll get the second name for you in a bit. But before we wrap up, we had to take two questions from our viewers. And the first one is coming in from Selassie Doku. She says she's a banker at Access Bank. All right. So she says she's worked with her company for 3 years and has plans of becoming somebody great with the bank like you. She said, give or take, how long do you think it would take her to get to MD position?
Listen, everybody has a different trajectory. I think, I don't know what she does. I don't know how she is, etc. But you know, hard work makes it, and she just plays her marker. So I will give an example. For instance, how I placed my marker. In 1995 or 96, the CEO of the bank at the time was asked to leave, and there was a lacuna. So I was 33 years old. I went to see the chairman, and I said they should make me the managing director. I was just ahead of me. I was going to be the CCU. C-suite person. And he says, you're too young. I said, but I can do the job. You know, I knew he wasn't going to give it to me. But in doing that, I had placed my marker. You know, so I would tell her that she just work hard, and you know, so that she's noticed. And I'm sure that she'll
make it. All right. Kelly Ben Idahosa inside Nigeria. She's actually locked in from Nigeria, says, what is the best way to invest your money in Ghana? I think he lives in Ghana. I'm not very sure.
She's asking for free consultancy.
Free one.
No, I'm unemployed, you know, so when I give consultancy, I must get paid something. No, I think that depends. I take a long-term view of. So when I go to the stock market, I open like Warren Buffett. So I think on the stock market, I'm taking a 30 to 45 year view, basically. So I'm looking to think of my grandchildren, basically. And But the other thing is on the fixed income market. So I'm talking financial investments. I think there's a lot of value in the euro bonds that are being issued and the long-term bonds that are being issued. Because they're yielding 18, the coupons are around 18 plus. These are 10, 12, 15-year bonds, you know, but there's a market for them. So you can actually go into those markets, those investments. You don't have to stay for the long haul, and then make some high yields. Yields which are definitely now better than city depreciation versus the dollar. So maybe they should look at those investments.
All right. Sir, thank you so much. Before we wrap up, what are your final words to the youth of Ghana, including myself?
My final words would be that, you know, there's a lot of despondency in the system, but they shouldn't be discouraged. They shouldn't disengage. They should definitely not pick up bad habits, because when you're stressed, when you're in such a difficult or bleak situation, you may pick up some bad habits. They should be careful about who they select as their role model. There's a lot of people on TV now, and a lot of them are, they're not good role models. But as a young person coming up, you may think that they are, because maybe they don't have cars or they seem to have money. You must be careful who you select as your role model. You must also understand, and this is something I tell my kids all the time, understand that whether you plan or not, your future will happen. So you must. Whether you plan or not, your future will happen. So you plan. And then as Bill Clinton said, we should be remembered by the power of our example and not by the example of our power. So these are my words to the youth of this country. Hopefully some of them will benefit from these words and make their lives good.
Uncle Frank, thank you so much for talking to us.
Thank you very much.
I remember yesterday we said it will be 2 hours. By God's grace, we've done 1 hour 47 minutes.
That's fine.
Thank you so much. We appreciate you. Keep on being yourself. Keep on inspiring the youth. Keep on changing the financial industry. I know you're done. You've retired, but your impact is still being felt to date. And I'm going to hold you on to that. After the 4 hours are done, I'm looking forward to seeing you in a higher position.
Well,
yes, I should be able to point fingers and say, Uncle Frank or Honorable Frank is my friend. I've met him before. Have a wonderful day, sir.
Thank you very much. You have a wonderful day.
Thanks for being with us.
Good afternoon to your listeners once again.
Thank you so much. Have a wonderful afternoon, too.
Bye.
Bye. This is YFM.